Thank you everyone for your patience and a warm welcome to everyone to the August edition of the Sprouts Environment Trust monthly lecture series. I welcome David Raju among us and I welcome all of y'all. We're very happy that Zoom is allowing us to get more audiences all across the world to participate and join in this webinar. Amrita, I would like you to introduce our speaker for the evening, Mr. David Raju.
Yeah. So the expert for our today's talk, David Raju, has been working in Central India for over 14 years and has been working with leading resorts, so wildlife resorts. He is a graduate in English literature, but always has had interest in science and animals. David has co-authored two books, namely Dragonflies of Kerala and a photographic field guide to wildlife of Central India, and is also currently working on his third book, Wildlife of South India. He was part of the team that has discovered 12 species of frog and 2 species of gecko, all new to science. So I welcome David Raju for Sprouts monthly lecture series.
Thank you, Amrita. Just a little before I hand over to David, a few more things I'd like to add. That one thing that all the young students and researchers who want to get into the career in natural history or as a naturalist is that you can see that although David is from an English literature background, he has made a very, very successful career in wildlife and in conservation. And David is one of the most friendliest faces and persons in the field of conservation. He's always helpful and supporting, whether it is our book work or, we did a festival called Nanhi in Madhya Pradesh. And David was so accommodating and helpful in getting the festival off its feet and keeping it running. So David supports many such activities. He's a part of the Kottayam Nature Club also, which hosts a lot of webinars. He's great with dragonflies. He's great with birds. So it's a pleasure being with David in the field, and we have our great pleasure having him today. So over to you, David, and everyone enjoy. If you are having issues with your audio, it's better that you log off and log in again, and we'll let you in. Yeah. So over to you, David.
Thank you so much, Amalant. I think I'll keep my video off. That's better. I'll start sharing the screen. I hope all of you can see my screen.
Yes.
Okay, so good evening, all of you. It's a pleasure to give a talk on wildlife of Western Ghats. I mean, it's interesting because I've been chasing this wildlife, especially in Western Ghats, for so many years with my friends. Been going around and... Yes.
Sorry, a little louder if you can hold the speaker a little closer. It's a little dim, the
sound. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So, it's been my passion to photograph whatever in Western Ghats and, documenting whatever I can. So, and also the way we contribute to the science. We have an amazing team, especially led by Dr. Anil Sakaria. So with him, we do a lot of surveys in parts of Western Ghats. Also, we have a team of dragonflies. We are a part of a society called Society for Odontic Studies, SOS. Do a lot of works there also. So, when Anand contacted me to give a talk on this topic, I never given a talk on wildlife, either frogs or a dragonfly especially. But let's see what we can hear today. Okay, so when you talk about the Western Ghats, Western Ghats is actually part of one of the global biodiversity hotspots. What you see here to the right, this is actually the Western Ghats, which is rich in biodiversity. If you've been to all these places, you might know that there's a amazing wildlife there. You name it for butterflies or frogs or snakes or any other reptiles. Everything, it's like a very rich biodiversity. So, next slide, what I showed here, this is actually something called the Palghat Gap. So during my talk, I'll be mentioning this specific place. This is actually, I mean, if you notice this, the slide to the left, this part, what you see, these are the Nilgiris here, and this is Annamalais. In between this part, around 30 to 40 kilometer wide gap here, which is actually was a barrier for a lot of animals. So that's why a lot of species got isolated these mountains, and it's eventually become a different species. So I'll be mentioning all this Palghat gap later. Okay, if you can just open your chat box and tell me what you can see here. Can anyone see here?
Okay, Rishan Sharma said gecko.
Okay.
Bark.
Bark.
Draco.
Yeah. I think tree I blew bark. The cover. Yeah, tree bark.
Yeah.
It's actually a gecko here. Let me point out here. Can you see my cursor here? So this is actually it's called Draco. It's actually a flying lizard here. So let me go to the next slide. This one. This is the picture actually in the previous slide. So now you try to locate it. So this is the eye of that lizard sitting here. This is the body. This is the legs, and the tail is coming down till here. Okay, find an animal here. Let's see. Let's start with some quiz. Let's see how many of you can find an animal here in this. Come on, open the chat box and give me answers.
Leaf bird. Somebody, Vivek Chandran said leaf bird.
Any other answers? If you are not able to see it, let me know. That also you can. Yeah, somebody said
snake. Snake. Chloropsis. Yeah, chloropsis. Again.
Somebody saying there's a mantis there. Okay. Baby Shalini saying leaf bird. Can see a black beak. Leaf
somebody
bird
said again. A mammal in background. Deer.
Yeah. Okay. Any other? Okay, somebody said there's a tiger. Wow.
Wow. Okay, owl, tiger.
Okay. Okay, so it's actually a leaf bird. Okay, let me point out. So the beak, what you see, this is, can you see the beak? And this is the body of the bird. Yes. And you can see the legs and the tail. Yeah. So this is the Jordan's leaf bird. Okay, let's try one more. This is the toughest one. Let's see. Who will get an animal here? And which animal also?
I think I can, but okay.
And you have to mention where you're seeing also. What animal and where you're seeing it?
Frog. Rishan said frog. Can you be more specific than frog?
Okay. Gas. What is that?
Purple frog.
I'm saying purple frog. Okay. Good one. Good try. Any other? I remember this I showed to even Vivek once. Vivek Philip Siriak. He took a lot of time. I hope he can point out there if he's there. Some
mythalizing.
Okay, guys. At least try to point out where it is. Any other guesses, guys? It's actually a tough one.
Yeah. Left of the log, hump-nosed viper.
Okay, hump-nosed viper. Good guess. Good try.
But where is it exactly that you have got to describe? Moth. Rahul Palekar is asking moth.
Okay.
But where? If you are seeing whatever.
Yeah, just point out.
Let's left side of log, lizard. Left okay. On left to the top of the stick.
Deepak is saying, okay.
Bottom left.
Okay, guys, it's actually, I'll point out, it's very difficult, very, very difficult to point out. Let me, where is that? Annotate.
Where?
I'm just trying to annotate that. Any other answers?
Middle of the stick.
Okay, I'll give you a clue. It's actually a frog.
Okay. Have you also lost it now, David?
No, I'm just saying. I mean, I am just trying to find the annotate cursor. Cursor.
Okay. The cursor is
Yeah. So this is the frog. Can you all see it? I'm just this tiny frog here. So this is the snout of the frog. This is the black thing is the eye. The black patch on the back, and this is the leg. This is the another leg here. So this is the frog here.
Yes.
Okay. So I just want to say, sometimes when you go to the jungle, this is what you see. I mean, there are animals out there, but you may not be able to see it. So you have to try to put a lot of effort to find a lot of animals. Okay. So, today we will be covering a lot of different animals. There will be butterflies, there will be dragonflies, there will be frogs and snakes and all, and some mammals and all. But let's start with my favorite insects, that is the dragonflies. I mean, I've been studying these dragonflies almost 15 years. This is my first love. So I've been chasing these amazing creatures. And this is one particular damselfly, which is called the Myristica saphir, which is found in the southern Western Ghats. It's very few pockets. You'll see it's very beautiful with a blue color, and on the top of the head it's got some reddish patch. And it's why it's called the Myristica saphir. I mean, if you look it to the right, there is a specific forest in Western Ghats. It's called the Myristica swamps. There you have
Hello,
David. Are you there,
David? I think his sound is. We have lost. Yeah, we'll wait for a sec. Sorry. Hello. Can you see me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah. So we'll just wait for, I think he's got disconnected. Kindly bear it because, you know, he's in Kerala. So he'll be back. So how many of you all have been to any part of Western Ghats, and which part of the Western Ghats have you all visited? If you all can put it in your chat windows in the meanwhile till David is back. Dandeli, okay. That's in Karnataka. Wayanad. Rahul says, Coorg, yeah, Chikmagalur, Thattekad, Bird Sanctuary, Kerala, Deepak says, Pradeep says, Silent Valley, that's great, Thattekad and these areas are great, Goa, okay, which part of Goa, Kudremukh, okay, nice, Periyar, Salim Ali Bird Sanctuary, there are two, actually, Salim Ali Bird Sanctuaries, one is in Kerala, one is in Goa, Annamalai, Periyar, Alapura, okay. Ratnagiri, okay. Ratnagiri is a big district, very specifically in Ratnagiri, Ramprasad. And Priyesh. Nilgiri is Annamalai, okay. Silent Valley, Periyar, Wayanad, Agastyamalai. Amrita, just take over. I'll check up with David in the meanwhile, please. Pranaj is staying, Coorg. David, you're back?
Okay. Yes.
Can we unmute him, Varun? Sorry, Amrita.
Yes, I did try to unmute. Yeah.
Okay, sorry guys, my power went off.
Okay, no problem.
Wi-Fi, really sorry.
Sure. Can you reshare your screen?
Yeah, one second. Is it visible?
Yeah, in the meanwhile, we asked him, asked people which parts of Western Ghats they have been to.
Yeah.
So quite a lot of places people have shared. Dandeli, okay. Goa. Continue, please.
Okay. So like I said, this is an amazing dumpster fly. I'll go to the next slide. That's actually an interesting slide, which my friend sketched. He painted this, Surya Ramachandran. So this is a typical habitat, what you see there. Interestingly, this forest is getting depleted every year because, even in Trivandrum, there's an amazing patch of Myristica forest. The government wanted to build a waste management plant there. And so the local people a lot of NGOs are also fighting to protect that forest. So this is a typical forest, which you can actually understand from this habitat, how these dragonflies survive. It's an amazing species to see it, and endangered species, difficult to see it, and also highly seasonal. You'll see them right after the monsoon for a few months, then they'll disappear. And interestingly, males are colorful and females are drab colors with a brown, and there's no blue marking on the body. And interestingly, this damselfly, when they sit somewhere, they actually always sit on the flowing streams, and wherever there's a half submerged twigs, that's a place they choose to rest. Here is another amazing dragonfly which found in Western Ghats. This is also reported in Central India and also in Northeast India, but it got an amazing breeding behavior. So this dragonfly, it's called the pygmy skimmer. Usually, butterflies, the dragonflies, they associated with the fresh water. All these dragonflies, they go to the water, lay eggs, sometimes some dragonflies choose the water weeds or water plants. They go and deposit their eggs there, and eventually it will hatch out into a larvae, and it will become an adult dragonfly. So, but this dragonfly, they have an amazing behavior. This, what they do, they actually, they lay eggs in stagnant water puddles. Especially they don't lay eggs directly into the water. Wherever there's overhanging branches, they go and lay eggs on those branches. When it rains, the water actually drop into these eggs, and the eggs hatches, the larvae actually drops into the water, and they'll survive. So it's a way to, get away from other predator. If a dragonfly directly going and laying eggs into the water. So there are a lot of predators, a lot of fishes and all, they'll go and eat the eggs. So this is one way to get away from all those predators. Here again, another amazing dragonfly, it's called the saffron retail, Platystica decanensis. The new Latin name is Indostica decanensis. I still prefer to call them the old Latin name. So this is a very beautiful damselfly which found in, especially in southern Western Ghats. Highly seasonal damselfly, especially right after the monsoon time. If you see this, the picture to the left, right after the monsoon, these damselflies will see them, these kind of streams, especially in dense evergreen forests where the streams are flowing, small streams, they'll go and lay eggs there, and they'll be there for a few, 1 or 2 months. Then again, they'll disappear. So imagine if you're walking through a thick evergreen patch of forest, you may not see this damselfly because it's black. Most of the time, the forest will be dark and the red color won't be much pronounced, and you may be able to see only the tip of the tail, this blue spot. I still remember with my friend Kiran, a few years ago, around 10 years back, when we were studying damsel dragonflies in Ponmudi in Trivandrum. So when we were walking through the jungle, suddenly we saw something, some flash of blue. Then we realized, oh, this is actually a damselfly. We didn't know what it was. We took a photograph later, we identified this. Again, another very amazing dragonfly. It's called the tricolored blood tail. Like I mentioned, dragonflies actually prefer fresh water. Wherever there's good water, there's a running stream. Sometimes they'll lay eggs in the streams or lakes. Sometimes they'll prefer water puddles and all. But this specific dragonfly prefer the tree holes. If you look at to the bottom right image here, so can you see a larva inside here? So this is actually a larva on the top here. That is a larva of this tricolored blood tick. So this particular dragonfly, you'll see them in Western Ghats, especially after the monsoon time. And they'll come and breed these kind of water puddle. Then they'll disappear. I mean, you may not see it you may see it only for 1 or 2 months, 2-3 months, then it will disappear. Because by the time, the monsoon will be over, 2-3 months. So, but these days what happened because of the global warming, the weather pattern change, we are not getting the actual monsoon in June. We are getting the monsoon, actual rain in August or mid-July onwards. So this is actually affecting their life cycle a lot. Okay, can anyone come to the chat box and tell me what butterfly is this? We are just going to talk about bit about butterflies. Let's see how many of we can get this butterfly right. Anyone there? Anyone who knows about butterflies, guys?
Please type your answers in the chat box.
Chat box, yeah.
Evening Brown, Reema Singh says.
Okay.
Some Evening Brown, Mittal Gala.
Okay. By the way, it's a Western Ghat. I mean, today's topic is Western Ghat.
Yeah.
So this butterfly found in Western Ghat.
Leaf butterfly.
With the Brown.
Evening Brown.
Any other guys?
Someone saying Evening Brown.
Okay.
Ashokan said Evening Brown.
Let's see.
Dingy bush brown.
No, nobody got so far. No one got the right answer. Let's see. Let's wait. Any tree brown.
Okay.
Bush brown. Cat's eye bush brown. No. Okay. Any other? It's a Western Ghat endemic butterfly. I'll give you one more clue.
Okay.
What is it? Bicyclus. I don't know what is that.
Some
butterfly.
That's a good one.
Okay, it's a bush brown. Any other guess now? Is there no butterfly guys here or what?
Mr. Ghate is saying long-banded bush brown.
No, it is not. Okay. Anyway, this is actually, I still remember when I saw this butterfly first time. This is called the red-eye bush brown. It is found in Nilgiris, in the top of the Nilgiris, especially above 1,500 meters or 2,000 meters and all. You usually see this butterfly, red-eye bush brown. I still remember this is almost 12 years back. I was doing a trip with Krishname Kunte and all. I mean, that time I didn't know there was a butterfly exists like that. So later in Nilgiris, we found this butterfly, we photographed it. Okay, so this is the butterfly to the left, that is the red-eye bush brown, and to the right is the reddish bush brown. So we spoke about Palghat gap, and this actually butterflies, the reddish bush brown actually found in south of Palghat gap, and the red-eye bush brown actually found on the north of Palghat gap. I mean, also they are found in the high altitude area, usually above 1,500 meters above sea level. This actually, this was the same butterfly probably 5-10 million years ago. And once the gap separated there, and also it got isolated there, this butterfly, and eventually evolved into a different species, two different species. So very unique butterflies. I mean, when they opened the wings here, to the left, it's actually, you can see actually a proper red eye here, and to the right it's actually a red disc. Again, we have another two butterflies. A lot of people consider this is still a subspecies, Palni fritillary and Nilgiri fritillary. Again, the Palni fritillary found in south of Palghat gap, and the Nilgiri fritillary found it especially in Nilgiris, I mean the north of Palghat gap. Anyone knows this butterfly? Come on, please type your answers in the chat box. Let's see how many of you. Again, it's a Western Ghat endemic butterfly.
Dusk.
Somebody said dusk. Okay. I'm pretty sure Bijesh should know this butterfly.
Somebody common Mormon.
Common Mormon. Okay, any other answers? It's a Western Ghat endemic. I'm just giving a clue. Blue bottle, no. Black Minarca, what is that? No, there's no such butterfly. Okay. Murugesan got
Malabar
it.
Right.
Yeah, Murugesan got it. It's actually Malabar banded. It's very similar to common Mormon, but it is actually Malabar banded swallowtail. Yeah. So this is a very unique butterfly to in Western Ghats. It's an endemic swallowtail, Malabar banded swallowtail. Interestingly, when they lay eggs, can you see the eggs? It's look like this. It's beautiful. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So this is actually an adaptation. When they lay eggs, other predators, they may not able to locate this as a eggs because it's look like a small part of the branch sticking out. And also when they have larvae, when they hatch out, they all sit together out in the open. They will not to have any camouflage. So this, these pictures are by Balakrishnan Valapil. So what he said, this could be an adaptation to the predators. I mean, the predators think, this is not a larvae. I mean, larvae don't come and sit out right in the open like that. So they actually form like in a big group, sometimes, 8 to 10 of them together and sit on a leaf. So the predators get confused. I mean, they think, it may not be larvae, and usually birds and other predators will avoid. So instead of doing a proper camouflage or a mimicry and all those things, this butterfly larvae actually took a bold step to show themselves. We are right here, we are big, but don't try to attack us, don't try to feed, because we are actually a large creature. So that's how they survive. This is something interesting thing happened in 2013. So that time I was with another person called Dr. Abraham Samuel. He's also very keen on dragonflies. So one day he called me, David, let's go and search for dragonflies in somewhere in Thattegarh. So both of us, we took a bus, a local bus, we went to Thattegarh. So we photographed a lot of dragonflies, very interesting ones we photographed. This. While coming back in a bus, I started seeing a lot of banana trees like this, and which had a lot of these large cells. So these are some butterfly, especially the Hesperidae. When they make their larvae cell, they roll the leaf and make this kind of large cell. So I tried to call up my two of my friends. I said they didn't respond. After some times, one of the friend called back and he said, David, what happened? I said, I think I saw a lot of large cells in banana plants. He said, get down from the bus now, right away. And I got down from the bus. And when I went to see a plantation, this what there. So we saw over 300 or 400 banana plantation was completely devastated by these butterflies. My friend said actually, this is a butterfly called banana skipper. That time it was known as a banana skipper. Now it's called the rounded palm red eye. So we walked into this banana plantation, and there was a guy who was actually trying to get rid of this butterfly. This was the first record of this butterfly in Western Ghat, in South India that time. So we didn't know this. We knew that this is like a rare butterfly, which is probably a rediscovery or something. We walked into, we collected a few larvae. We opened the cell and saw it. So, but when we spoke to that guy who was there with his banana plantation, he said, guys, you want to see the eggs? So this is what he said. He actually took us around and pulled out. He said, then to the right, what do you see? This is freshly laid eggs, probably an hour or two. And to the left, once it gets older, the eggs actually change colors into red. And then he opened a cell. This is the cell, what you see to the right. That's a cell of a butterfly. And the larvae actually stay inside this cell, all the Hesperid. And it was destroying his plantation. He said, guys, you guys love butterflies. And we don't want to tell him we like butterflies. We study butterflies and all. Because when we see a person whose bread and butter is that banana plantation, and it's been destroying by a particular butterfly. So this is the rounded palm red eye. Later we did the studies and realized it is actually the first record for Western Ghat. And there was no predators that time. So, and the butterflies were going haywire. I mean, they were destroying all kinds of whatever banana plants. When it's sad to see, imagine 300 or 400 banana plants be completely destroyed. But later, all the birds, like the rufous tree pie and common crow and large bill crow, they all figured out, even the kukul, they all figured out how to repeat open this cell, and they figured out it's actually a large larvae. So they started feeding. Now the number is come down pretty drastically. Interestingly, when we found this butterfly in 2013, it was only in a few pockets of Kerala. Eventually, it's distributed. I mean, it's gone up to now in, I think, in Amboli also, in Maharashtra.
Can you see a person doing things with it?
Okay. There is another interesting butterfly. I mean, most of you guys know this butterfly. This is called the common albatross here. This is one amazing thing happen every year in India. I mean, now there's a butterfly migration happening. This is pictures from Aralam Wildlife Sanctuary in northern Kerala. I mean, especially in January and all, there is hundreds of these butterflies, not hundreds, thousands or lakhs of butterflies will congregate there. And they have this amazing migration, especially they follow a kind of path just over the river. There's a particular river there. So all these butterflies fly over those rivers and congregate there. Interestingly, this butterfly actually breed on the top of the hills. Thousands of them breed, and it's actually a population explosion happened there. Then they fly down there and they'll all disappear there. After that, no one see where they goes and all. Nobody, still it's a mystery. And the same time, if you walk into another part of that same forest in Aralam, I mean, I never seen, it's, I think everyone, those who are keen on butterfly, they all should see this magical moment. We all saw at least millions of butterflies surrounded us. These are mostly the dark blue tigers and common crows and double banded crows and all. So all these butterflies, they actually congregate in particular. I still remember that place. We couldn't count, the numbers were so high. We just stood there and enjoyed. I mean, millions of butterflies around us. So every year they do have a butterfly survey there in a butterfly migration survey in January. Those who are interested, please go. It's a lifetime experience, I must say. Okay, now let's move on to some frogs. This is one of amazing frog which is recently described in 2003. I mean, most of you know this frog. It's called the purple frog or the pig-nosed frog. Interestingly, the closest relative of this frog actually lives in the Seychelles. And this frog, it's a pre-monsoon breeder. Like in May, we get a good shower, pre-monsoon shower. So that's the time these frogs actually come out from underground. So this frog actually known to go underground. They live there the whole year. Only though that pre-monsoon time, they'll come out and breed. Especially they prefer this kind of waterfalls or running streams, especially where there are falls. They'll get into these kind of areas and they lay eggs in these crevices. And once the eggs hatch out, when it become a tadpole actually climb into these waterfalls, these small waterfalls. Sometimes it's good heavy waterfalls also, and cling on to these waterfalls and survive there. Once it get adult stage, they'll eventually go back to the underground. So this is an amazing frog. There's a video here. I don't think it will play.
You'll have to, David, first change the setting on your system.
Okay. That's okay.
Play the video sound.
Okay, that's okay.
No, you can play it. The video will play.
Okay, the sound. Okay. We'll ignore it. I mean, there's so many things to cover, no? So it's already 5:45. Okay, so after a few years, 2003, our team headed by Dr. Anil Zakaria and Robin Kurian Abraham. So they discovered the entire life history of this purple frog. This is probably one of the pathbreaking study of amphibian, the natural history study. I mean, Dr. Anil is always wanted to study the breeding behaviors of frogs. So this is one of the first he discovered it and described it. Again, we have an amazing frog. It's called the Ferguson stoat. It's the Tophrinus parietalis. It's found in the high altitude, I mean, mid elevation to high, not very high, like 500, 600 meters to probably 1000 meters above sea level. This frog, it's called the Ferguson stoat. I mean, interestingly, if you look just over the head, can you see this black line, this extra like a Y, inverted Y? So this is the identification of this Ferguson stoat. It got a very unique breeding behavior. I mean, most of the frogs, they breed in monsoon time or pre-monsoon time, or you know, sometimes some frogs will breed whenever they have rains, like the skittering frog or gliding frogs, Malabar gliding frog and all. Whenever there is heavy rain, they'll breed. But interestingly, this frog, this Ferguson stoat, it's known to breed in a peak winter, like in January, February, or in December, especially in those hills. They'll have a heavy winter there. From that winter, they'll have a kind of a drizzle from the mist. So especially in Wayanad region and all, there'll be a lot of mist there during in winter time. And from that mist, there'll be a slight drizzle. So this frog need those kind of the habitat to breed. So unfortunately, a few years ago,
hello David, hello. Hello, David, are you there? His screen is sharing, so he's, I think, online. Okay, yeah, I guess so. Right. So, see, these are some of the challenges we face when we are doing a live webinar or trying to get you a resource person from remote areas, that we sometimes have to, you know, bear with a little bit of disconnection. So we're apologetic about that. We're really sorry. I hope you are getting to understand from this presentation that there are some very unique species which are there. People are yet looking at tigers. People are yet looking at big fauna, hornbills, etc. But there is a lot of small fauna, small species, whether it's dragonflies, whether it is frogs and toads, which are there, which need to be given a lot of attention. Like the Myristica swamp that he told you, it's called a relic forest. There are very small areas where these forests are limited, and a development project, a road or a mining project that coming in over there is going to completely destroy the ecosystem. So the water and the species that are related with that, all that is going to get reduced. How is Kerala remote? I'm not saying remote in the sense of roads not being present or geography not being there. What happens is that these places have leeches in them. Many of them have king cobra. Many of them have elephants. Wild bears are of course there. So people tend to stick to some very popular wildlife areas. So they'll go to Periyar. They'll go to Thattekar. They'll go to very specific areas. And they don't go to parts, where. So people who are in Kerala might be going, but the people from remaining parts of the country, they might travel all the way from here to go to Eagle Nest in Arunachal. But they may not go to Ashambur Hills, or they may not go to Agastya Malai, or, parts of, Anamalai, etc. Very famous, parts which can be driven to, parts which you can, get resorts to stay in, Coorg, etc. are pretty popular with people. But otherwise, many places on the Chinnar Wildlife Sanctuary and all, nobody has been. Very, very rarely people go to those areas. They are not sort of what you call as touristy. And even after you go for tourism over there, what you look at are the larger, the megafauna. And what David is trying to expose you through this is the unique and recently found or rarely kind of, documented species that are there. I'll just check up with him again. I hope you all are finding this talk interesting. Hello. Sure. Uh, So David is joining in a second. He's come back. In fact, if we had things like satellite telephones, etc., we could have even had researchers who are working in the field, whether it is Nagaland or whether it is Siachen or whichever areas. Yeah. David is back now. David, can you please reshare your screen?
Sorry, guys. Yeah.
No problem at all. Your internet is a little weak, David.
Is it?
Your voice is cracking.
One second.
Hello? Amruta, can you see? Hello? Hello?
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you.
Is it better than network?
Yes, better.
Okay.
You'll have to reshare your screen, please.
Okay. Really sorry, guys.
No issues.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Okay. Just for the records, I think the previous slide, what I showed, the common name is wrong because it's not Ferguson Stodd. That is, Ferguson Stodd is Dathaphrenes cava, this is Aritalis. Like I mentioned, this frog actually breed in high altitude hills in southern Western Ghat and breed in peak winter time. Let's move on to the next frog. We have an amazing family of frog. They are called the night frogs. These frogs actually, you usually see them in running streams and also the marshes, some place of high altitude marshes and all. They have a unique behavior, especially the male known to guard itself. The one what you see to the left, it's actually Nyctibetrachus grandis, one of the large night frog which found in Wayanad region. And they fiercely guard their eggs. One to the right, what you see is the night frog. It's by Dr. Gurla. He discovered and described this species. So this actually laying egg, we want to take out some mud and dust it. On and eventually, so this won't be able
to. David, your network is bad again. Oh, I think he dropped. So some of you all might have also heard a babbler calling in the background at David's place. Thank you, Gauri. Thank you, Avi Sabhawala. David is back.
Hello.
Yeah. Okay. Yellow-billed babbler. That's right. It's an endemic.
Yeah. No.
David, I think if you're sharing your screen, maybe your net is going slow. Hello?
Yeah, one second. Yeah.
When you're sharing your screen, I think it's taking up your internet. Can you hear us? Okay. Hello? David? Hello? David?
He again blinked.
Okay, so what I'll do is I think I'll share the screen from my end so that he can just talk and save his bat. Hello. Yeah, I was just going to say that. I will share the screen and you talk on the talk. Yeah. Amruta?
Yeah, I'll share.
Yeah, please. Thank you. You can share the screen? Yeah. Thank you, Amruta. Right. Is David back in?
Since yeah. I'm sharing the screen, I can't see.
Maybe he's joined. I've added it.
Oh, okay.
I think I'll have to unmute him 1 second. Wait, where is he? David, are you there? He had joined and in case you have any questions and suggestions for what topic you would like to have for future talks. Please type them into the chat window. David, can you unmute yourself? Dwiti, if you can unmute.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. I now logged in from my phone. This is better now.
Yes, it's good. So Amruta is sharing the screen. You can continue.
Okay. This is an amazing frog which is found in Western Ghat. It's called the Canopy bush frog, Rauorchestis neurostrigona. Interestingly, the Latin name, the scientific name, it's called the water drop. The sounds, I mean, can you play the sound, Amruta? Next.
Actually, I could, this is that PDF file, so it's not, the audio is not playing.
Okay, no problem. Okay, so this particular frog, we imagine if you have a cut of water, this actually dropping into the bucket of water. So that's where it sounds. So that's where the name also comes, water drop frog. Can you please change next slide? Hello?
Yeah, she's changed it.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, so this is again another amazing set of family of frogs. I mean, we are again the bush frog, Rauorchestis, but these all frogs are called the reed frogs. So this reed, interestingly, in Western Ghat, we have a lot of Auckland reeds, a specific bamboo. This frog kind of beat also small slits in the holes. And they get inside and they breed. Especially the males are known to guard its eggs. And the one what you see to the left is the Rauorchestis chalasodus. So is the Rauorchestis manohari, which our team is discovered that. And the one to the right is the Rauorchestis auckland. Okay, next slide.
Amrita, next slide, please.
Okay. This is two of the very enigmatic frogs which is found in Western Ghat. One is Rauorchestis resplendens, called the resplendent bush frog, which found only on the top of the hills of Munnar, especially Iravikulam National Park and a few pockets in those areas. Again, a critically endangered species. Probably this is again one of the first frog is going to extinct because of the global warming. Somebody is saying sound is bugging. Am I audible, Anand? Is it okay?
Yes, it is. Yeah. It's clear now.
It's fine, no?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. The frog, what you see to the right, Rauorchestis montanus, that frog, it's actually fully on the top of a peak in Kumuk. So, and also the it's nowhere else in the world. Probably less than a few hundred in the wild. These are probably the two frogs it's going to extinct because of the global warming. I mean, if the temperature rises 1 or 2 degrees, they're going to go. They're going to get extinct. Okay, next slide, please.
Yeah.
We have another amazing frog, which is called the Myristica swamp frog. Mercurana myristica palustris. It's found in, like I mentioned, with the dragonflies. This frog also found in that myristica swamp. So myristica is actually a nutmeg family of trees, which swamps where these frogs are found. A few years ago, we discovered this frog. And what you see to the right, bottom right, is the female of that frog. Next picture, please. Our team actually discovered its breeding behavior. So why it's very interesting, this frog? This frog can come out soon, probably in May, and hundreds of frogs gathered in particular Myristica swamps, where the males, like the brown ones, are male. There'll be hundreds of them will be around, and a few, and the picture what you see to the bottom right, it's actually a Myristica swamp where it's already dry there. Imagine a forest with in summertime it will be dry, but in beginning of the pre-monsoon they'll have a few showers, so the forest floor will be wet. So that's the time these frogs actually come out and breed. They'll come out and amplex. They'll go into the, they'll be actually doing all the leaves and going into leaf litter, then eventually they started laying eggs there, and they mix it with the mud and they'll disappear from there. So after a few weeks, the monsoon will start, and all those areas what you see there to the right, it'll get flooded, and eventually the frog will, the eggs will be hatched out and become a tadpole, and they'll survive. So what happens, because if you look at the weather pattern for past few years, we are not getting the monsoon, proper monsoon in June, July. So these frogs will come out in mid-May, they breed. But after that, there's no proper rain. So all their eggs will either die out or they disappear. So, I mean, global warming actually going to affect this frog. Okay, next one.
Yeah. So David, when you say it comes out, do they burrow into the soil or what happens? Where do they go? Any idea?
Okay. We have a theory. I mean, if you go back to that, the male and female picture, the male actually got brownish in color. So most of these frogs, you know, most of these bush frogs and all, they actually stays in the ground, in the leaf litters. So probably the female actually stays on the trees, probably some burrows or whatever it is. That's why she'll have the much more greener color. So that's what our theory says. But we don't know exactly until we do some more studies. We don't know.
Great. Thank you. Okay. Next time.
Okay, I'll quickly go through this. This is again a unique animal in Western Ghat. It is found over a few pockets in Nilgiris and in Western Ghats and in parts of August Himalaya and all. So Nilgiri thars are a few thousands left in the wild. And also this is again one of the first animal maybe get extinct during the when if the temperature rises, because most of all these animals, what I mentioned here, when the temperature rises, they'll actually try to find much cooler place. So these Nilgiri thars also usually lives on the top of these mountains peaks. After when the temperature increases, they have no place to go. They'll go on the top of the peak and eventually they might get wiped out from there. Okay, next one.
Yeah.
This is again a very unique animal in Western Ghats. I don't know how many of you have seen it. It's very difficult to see, but it is not rare in Western Ghats. There are a lot of people have seen it. I've seen it 2-3 times. I remember there's a place in Munnar. It's called the Pambadam Sholay National Park, which is probably the best place to see this amazing animal. And they are very ferocious animal. I mean, it's wrong to say ferocious in animal terms. They are not, I mean, they eat even deer and small rodents, birds, still. Their forest guards even said they've been chased by this amazing animal. So look out when you go to the Western Ghats forest, even the Evergreen forest next time. Try to look out for these animals, Nilgiri martin. Next slide.
Are they diurnal or nocturnal?
I think largely nocturnal, but people have seen them in the daytime also. There's, I don't know exactly. Probably let me try to find out and get back.
Sure.
Okay. Again, a very unique animal in Western Ghats. It's called the Malabar spiny dormouse. If you look at the scientific name, Platycanthemis laceris. Interestingly, in this genus, only two species are there in the world. One, we have it in Western Ghats. The other one is found in China. So imagine the closest relatives is in China. And also, if you look at the back of this mouse, dormouse, it's some of the hair actually look like a spine. It's got a very spiky spine. Probably, you know, that's why it's got its name, Malabar spiny dormouse. And it's actually a seed predator. This mouse actually known to feed on a lot of fruits, especially Heliocarpus species and Myristica and all. And when you walk through the forest, especially you can see a lot of fruits are fallen down on the forest floor with a lot of holes. That means the spiny dormouse are around. And look at the tail. It's got very unique tail. And yeah, it's a very unique animal to look out in Western Ghats. Next one. I mean, I don't know how many of you know this. We have the smallest mammal in India or in the by smallest mammal by animal is shrew with 1.8 grams or 2 grams and 1.5 to 2 inches size. I mean, I remember my studying this shrews and all in Western Ghats. So he said this when this shrew ran away through the forest floor, it's looked like a cockroach, a black cockroach running around through the that. I mean, you may confuse it like a running cockroach, but this is the smallest mammal in Western Ghats. Next one. Again, a unique animal in Western Ghats. It's called the Madras hedgehog or bare-bellied hedgehog. It's found in few drier parts of the Western Ghats. This picture is actually by Ashwin, my friend. He taken this from Satyamangalam forest, and it's there in Satyamangalam and some other forest, but not many people don't know where it's actually, its distribution, what is the breeding behavior, nothing much known about this animal. So again, if you are visiting any of those parks, highly nocturnal, that's the only thing I know, but otherwise nothing much known about this animal. Next one, please.
Which is this area where you saw the Madras hedgehog?
That is, see, a few records. One is there, they got a specimen in Komaragam. I don't know how they from the stream they got it from the river. Otherwise, okay. In Satyamangalam, my friend photographed it. I mean, it's. I think there's a pretty good population is there. It's reported in Tamil Nadu also.
Okay.
But right. Other part also.
Yeah.
Okay, and identify these two squirrels. If you can come to the chat box and tell me what it is.
You can type out the
answers. 1 and 2. Just say number 1, what is it? Number 2, what is it? Triple striped. Okay. because this squirrels actually a lot of misidentified. I'm only also number yes. one is triple stripe.
Three-stripe.
Okay.
Palm squirrel.
Any others? Pranati said, okay.
Ramaskur.
Okay, Gayatri Singh, Ramaskur, okay.
And second is
Pranati Singh, Dusky Palm Squirrel. Okay, Asiatic. First one is three-stripe, Asiatic stripe, Malabar, five-striped. Any other answers, guys?
Someone on Facebook Live has said Trishru.
No, Trishru.
No, okay. That's wrong.
Wrong, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so somebody said one five-striped and three-striped. I think quite a few guys got it right. The first one, it's actually a three-striped palm squirrel. But the second one is actually, it's called the jungle-striped palm squirrel. Go to the next slide, please.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, I remember one of my friend also been studying wildlife. Sorry? Do you this have is it this in Maharashtra?
Yeah, Devruk and Ratnagiri, that area we do have.
Yeah, so right. Interestingly, a lot of people actually misidentified this animal. So, let me tell you, this three-stripe palm squirrel, it's largely found in a drier areas, and jungle stripe, it's a wet areas which mainly found. So, yeah. Easy way to differentiate, if you look at the face of this jungle, it's a and even the rump also, the starting place of the tail, it's actually got a rufous color. So these are the two keys when you look out for these animals. So a lot of people actually misidentify. Interestingly, if you go to Periyar, in Kumali town, you'll get the three-stripe palm squirrel. If you go to the 2 kilometers away in where the forest rest house and all, there where you see the jungle-stripe palm squirrel. Okay, next slide, please.
Also, the call of the jungle stripe is a little harsher than the three-stripe palm squirrel. Hello?
Yeah.
Hello?
Okay.
Yeah. Your voice is dragging a little. David, your voice is dragging. Can you pause and start again? Hello.
Is it better now?
Yes. Clear.
Okay. So this is again a unique squirrel found in Western Ghat. This is called the Nilgiri striped squirrel. Very tiny squirrel. A lot of people, when they see it first time, they think it's actually a baby squirrel or something. But it's actually a different species altogether. It's also called the bamboo squirrel also. Next time when we are in Western Ghat, especially the evergreen forest and all, keep a lookout for this squirrel. Okay, next slide, please. Most of you have seen this giant squirrels in Western Ghat, but I just want to point out two interesting things, especially the one you see to the left, it's a Ratufa indica indica. It's a different subspecies which found in north of Palghat Gap, and one to the right, what you see, Ratufa indica maxima, it's actually the south of Palghat Gap. So with a complete black tail, the one which found on the, especially, you get in Maharashtra also, no, this one, and Goa and all parts
yes,
of it.
Yes, yeah.
Ratufa indica, which is slightly smaller in size, and plus the tail is rufous in color. But Ratufa indica maxima, it's larger than the other one. And plus, it's found only in south of Palghat Gap. The next one.
So there are no regional common names that are there for these, right? For the subspecies?
No, I mean, eventually, I think they are planning to this describe into a different species or different to some species, work.
Yeah.
That's what
yeah.
I heard.
Yeah.
Again, this is a very unique squirrel, which is called the gristle giant squirrel. This is it's not found in a wet patch of the forest. This is found in drier areas of Western Ghats, especially in Chinar region and some parts of Kaveri Wildlife Sanctuary and all, which is found there.
Yeah.
Next one.
It's one of my favorite giant squirrel species.
Yeah, it's amazing. How many of you have seen this animal? Anand, have you seen it?
Yeah. I think this was in probably Munnar, I think. I'm not sure.
Okay. Because a lot of people actually get confused this animal. Remember when we were in Munnar also, people thought it's actually a grey mongoose.
Grey mongoose, yeah.
They called it a grey mongoose, but then we pointed out it's actually a brown mongoose. It's a rare species of mongoose which found in parts of Western Ghats. Look out for it. It's much more darker than the grey mongoose.
So we'll definitely plan a trip with David. Pranad is asking, when are you going to show us? So I think David have to plan after the lockdown is over somewhere in January, February, if we can have a biodiversity get together.
Yeah. Next slide.
Yeah. Can you see it, David?
Yeah. Okay, so this is a unique animal in Western Ghats. It's called the Malabar slender loris. Interestingly, we have two subspecies of loris, slender loris in Western Ghats. One is called the Malabar slender loris. The other one is the Mysore slender loris. If you see the map to the right, one which is pointed in blue, which is the Mysore slender loris, and one pointed out the red patch, that is the Malabar slender loris. So interestingly, the Malabar slender loris is found only in wet evergreen forest, and the Mysore slender loris is actually found in the drier areas of the Western Ghats and part of Eastern Ghats, and widely distributed. In Eastern Ghats also it is reported.
So what is there in Bangalore is the Mysore slender loris?
Mysore slender loris, yeah.
Okay, great. Yeah, Amrita, next. Yeah, they are primates, Amol.
Yeah, they are primates. Okay, again, two unique animals here. This is a lion-tailed macaque and Nilgiri langurs. I think I don't have to explain much about it. It is the iconic animals of Western Ghats. A few thousands are left in the wild. I still remember when we are watching golden langurs with my friend Karun in Manas National Park. He turned around and told me, David, your Nilgiri langurs are much beautiful than the golden langurs. I mean, imagine, look at that color, it's a jet black with that white mane.
Yeah.
Next slide. Now let's talk about some interesting birds. I mean, when I was thinking to talk about birds, the only birds I wanted to talk about is the laughing thrush only. So this is a very unique laughing thrush, Wynad laughing thrush, widely distributed in Western Ghats. Probably the best place to see it is in Periyar or in Valpara. It's actually a good place to see. The closest relatives actually lives in Northeast India. This is this is the only laughing thrush here. If you go to the next slide, we have some other interesting laughing thrushes. Okay, these are used to call as laughing thrushes. Now they actually put them into chilipins. So we have four species of chilipins in Western Ghats, the Nilgiri chilipin and Banasura chilipin. Those two are found in north of Palghat Gap, and other two, the Palani chilipin and Ashambu chilipins, are found in south of Palghat Gap. So interestingly, the Nilgiri chilipin is found in Nilgiri, Ooty, and Kotagiri, Kunur, and even parts of Silent Valley and all. But if you look at the Banasura chilipins, I mean, those who know about the bit of biogeography and all, in Nilgiris, we have another set of hills. They are called the Camel Hump Mountains, which around 8 to 10 hilltops. These birds are found only in those probably 5 or 6 mountain peaks, especially in Banasura and Chembra, and those places this bird occur. It's probably the rarest bird in Western Ghats. A lot of birders actually wanted to see. And if you look at the bird to the right, the top one, Palani Chilapan found in Munnar and Kodaikanal and Kodai. Pretty common, very easy to find. But the, again, another rare one just below, the Ashambu Chilapan, which is found north of, I mean, the in, right after the Shengote Gap, there is actually a, if you look in that map, extreme below, I have marked there the Shengote Gap. It's actually found found south of Shengote Gap. So that is again a rare chilapan. So this laughing thrushes or chilapans is actually more close to the babblers. It's actually a mountain babblers than a laughing thrushes. Or if you have been to Northeast and all, if you know the Sibiyas and Minlas and all, they're actually closely related to those birds than the laughing thrushes. So that's why they actually changed the name also. The chilapans. Also, these birds have a very peculiar behavior. Every 1 hour, they'll congregate and they'll start making sounds. So entire valley will be full of their sound. They'll communicate to each other, other groups and all. Next one. A very amazing set of birds. They are called the Sholakilis. We used to call them as short wings. I mean, the white-bellied short wings. And the Nilgiri short wing mainly found in north of Palghat Gap, white-bellied short wing, which was south of. Now they actually change it Sholakili. So the recent study has revealed that they're actually close to the flycatchers. So technically they are flycatchers. Mm. The next one. Okay. I've done few trips with my friends to look for earthworms. So a few of my friends actually study earthworms. So few things I learned. I mean, in there is a river called Chaliar in Calicut and Malappuram district. Where in that basin we have a large earthworm, which is called the Dravida nilamborensis. This is the largest earthworm in Asia. So it's sometimes grow over a meter size. Imagine a earthworm over a meter size. It's amazing. Okay, the next one. We have another interesting earthworm, which is not an endemic to Western Ghats, but it's creating a lot of issues. This is actually an exotic earthworm. So my friends were saying when they were digging for these earthworms all over Kerala, this earthworm is there from the top of 2,200 meters till the sea level. So probably when we brought rubber and tapioca to Western Ghats to Kerala, so this earthworm came with that. So eventually it spread all over. It's actually creating a big pest also. It's bad for our habitat. Okay, next one. Again, we have an endemic wasp here. It's a paper wasp in Vespidae family. It's called Rhopalidae montana. It's a small one. It look like a tiny ants, flying ants. It's the size of an ant. And again, found above 500, 600 meter above sea level. And widely distributed, but it's an endemic one. I think in Vespidae family, no other wasps are endemic. Look out next time when we are out there in the forest. Next one. Okay, now let's talk about some reptiles. I mean, and my favorite groups, especially the shield tail. I think my friend is already here in this group. I mean, he's also watching this shield tails. He studies shield tails. So shield tails are an amazing family of snakes which found in Western Ghats. So they comes in different colors and different shapes. I think over 50 species are reported here. The next slide, please. I mean, if you look at their tails, if you look on the top left, actually you can see a tip of the tail. It's actually a round shape. And one below, it's actually got a cut shaped tail. It's feel like somebody cut its tail. Another two, three of them got a pointed tails. So one amazing thing about these shield tails, this tip of the tail actually very hard. They got a very hard shells. If any birds and all, if they try to attack head, if you look at the picture on the top right, they're actually hiding their head and the tail is out. So the predators, even birds and all, they'll try to bite the tail, and the tails are pretty hard. So they won't be able to bite it after a few minutes. You know, birds actually, you know, they are actually spending too much time on this prey. So they leave this snake and try to forage for some other food. So that's why they survive, and they comes in different colors of colors and shapes. Okay, next one. If you have any questions and all, I think Vivek can answer it. He's here.
No. David will take the questions at the end now.
Yeah, not now. I mean later. Yeah.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Look at all these colorful things. I mean, they are brightly colored, beautiful colors, all these snakes. And we have around 6 or 7 genus of these shielded. Next one. Next slide.
Yeah, changed.
Yeah, okay. Here is two widely distributed. One is the Elliot shieldtail on the top left. This is, I remember I seen this shieldtail in, it's there in Pachmadi. Anant, if you remember in Pachmadi.
Yes, yes.
When you've done that butterfly survey, it's there in Pachmadi, it's there in Northern Western Ghat, it's there in Central Western Ghat, it's there in Southern Western Ghat. So this, interestingly, this shieldtail is widely distributed. But it's morphologically very different. If you check the morphology of this snake, same species in Northern Western Ghat and Southern Western Ghat, these are very different morphologically, but genetically they are same. But there is another shield tail just below, the Periyar shield tail, which is all look same. I mean, if you take a shield tail from Periyar and another one from Idukki, same, they look very similar, but morphologically also they are same. But genetically, those snakes are very different. I mean, they're still confused what to do with those snakes. I mean, morphologically, one snake is different, but genetically, they are not. But other snake, it is actually morphologically same, but genetically, they are very different. So they are confused with all this. Taxonomists are confused what to do with these snakes. I'm sure there are quite a few species will be discovered soon. Next one. Okay, so these are the different genus of shield tails. One is Melanophidium, which is completely black, shiny black and all. Then Europeltis, Tertorus, Rhinophis and Plecturus and Pseudoplecturus. And one to the left, the Rhinophis actually, bottom left, which found in India and also in Sri Lanka also. That is only genus of shield tails found in Sri Lanka. The next one. Okay, can anyone guess this snake? Not Vivek, anyone else can. What snake is this? Can you come into the chat box and tell me what it is? Nobody want to take a risk or what? Okay, somebody said Bibron's coral snake. Okay, anyone else?
Coral, okay,
Sridhar. Sridhar is saying coral snake. Any other?
I'm shield tail, I'm guessing. Milk coral, Rishan is saying.
Milk coral.
Oui.
Serotype flow vermicularis, my goodness. Oh. Any other? Any other guess? Okay, this, like Pranath said, it's actually a shield tail. I mean, I remember when I wrote this is picture by Lily Margaret. So I wrote her. This is a species called Platyplectrus trilineatus. If you can change the next slide, Anand. So this is actually found mainly in Munnar and Armalai Hills and all, this shield tail. It's very pretty. It's very similar to the coral snake. So this is, look at the one to the right. It's called the striped coral. It's mimic actually the this coral snake. When I got the email from Lily, so I didn't open them. I told her to send a picture of a shield tail, but I thought why she sent a coral snake picture. I didn't open, but a few days later I said, let's open it and check it, and I sent it to my friend. Then he said, yeah, this is the snake. So this is probably a Batesian mimicry happening here, because this tri-striped shield tail, Platyplectrus trilineus, is actually mimicking this striped coral. So all the birds are actually think it's actually a venomous snake, so they avoid it. So this snake also getting benefit from that. Okay, next one. I think some of you said already, this is a Bibron's coral snake. It's again widely distributed in Western Ghat. Interestingly, we have another new species of coral snake, shield tail, which look very similar like this. but it's not at describe. It's there in especially Wayanad region and all. But yeah, I seen a picture of a road clean. Imagine, shieldtail look like this.
Exactly. It's an interesting, but shieldtail and coral snakes looking similar to each other. It's
I think the previous one actually found in the same habitat also in Muna region. They found in Anomalies. Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah. So.
Interesting.
Again, a very unique turtle. I mean, not many people have seen it in the wild. I think I seen it only once. It's a cane turtle, smallest turtle. In India, it's a
Hello, David. Hello, David. Your voice is cracking.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Could you repeat the last part, please?
Is it better now?
Yes, very clear now.
This is again, a unique turtle, which is those who want to going to have a trial luck for to see this turtle, Adrapalli and Vadachal forest in Kerala, where there's that famous Bahubali movie shot. No, that's a place to see this turtle. I think that's one of the good place to see.
And named after the first lady.
Vijaya. Oh, I think we should mention this. She's actually probably the first lady herpetologist in India to study. She went out there and spent so many months to track this turtle and study them. So that's why, to honor her name, I mean, the turtle genus is changed. It's Vijayachalis now.
Yeah.
Okay, next slide. We have another amazing species of skinks. It's called the cat skinks in Western Ghat. Very colorful, brightly colored. It's called Restella genus. One is Restella travancorica on the top left. One to the right is Restella rurki. Interestingly, one unique thing about these Restellas, they have retractable claws like our cats. They can take out their the claws whenever they want it. So that's why they are called the cat skinks. Very beautiful, colorful, and mainly found in high altitudes of Western Ghats. Next one. Again, unique snakes in Western Ghats, mainly found in Nilgiris. This is what we can call it, a point endemic in the high altitude of Nilgiris and grasslands and rocky plateau. Usually found in above 1800 meters or 2000 meters and all. And very small, and it's, if you look just on the top of the, just behind the head, I mean on the neck, you can see a horseshoe mark there. So that's why it's called the horseshoe. Next one. This is recently described a gecko, Zakrai, is a dwarf gecko, Nemaspis Zakrai. It's actually named after my sir, Dr. Anil Zakaria. It is found in Wayanad and few other places.
Your sound is cracking again, David.
Yeah. Is it better now?
No. Hello?
Is it okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so this gecko actually. Am I audible now?
Yes, you are.
Okay, so yeah, this gecko is actually found in Wayanad region. It's the largest of Nemaspis or the day geckos, but people used to call it all the Nemaspis are day geckos. They are actually not day geckos. You won't see these geckos in the daytime. You'll see them only at night. And interestingly, my friends, they had proper permission to collect and study and all. They knew this was a new species. when they caught this species from a cave, after a few minutes, it's died. I mean, so this was actually, imagine it's actually so adapted to that ecosystem. See, the moment you catch it, they're going to die. So it's actually a big threat. I mean, if you any quarries start near any rocky areas around these geckos, the species is going to get extinct. Okay, next one. This is also again a very unique gecko which is found on the in Anomalies. I was also there when they discovered this gecko, Anomaly day gecko or Anomaly dwarf gecko, Nemaspis anomaliensis. Interestingly, most of you know that last month, a few or two, 3 weeks back, there was a big landslide happened in Kerala, in Pettimudi. It's called Pettimudi in close to Irvigulam National Park. So this gecko is actually the same Shola what we got it. So we don't know what happened to that area. Probably a few years, few days or few weeks later, we'll go and study this gecko. Then we come to know that. Because most of these Nemaspis geckos are point endemics. They are found in a particular areas. So we haven't located this gecko in any other parts of Munnar. So we'll have to go and check what will happen there. Are they still there, or with that landslide, all of them are got wiped out, or what? Slide. There are some unique flowers. We'll just talk about some more flowers now. So these are my favorite flowers. Impatiens. One on the top left is the Impatiens finnicia, and one lower down is the Impatiens violaceae. To the bottom right is Impatiens parasitica. All those are found in Munnar region, and all. It's very pretty. Over 50-60 species are found. Very colorful, brightly colored, mainly seen in right after the monsoon time. Next one. I mean, most of you know this. What is this? I think, Anand, you know this, no?
1 second. I can't see it.
Yeah, somebody already, Sridhar Anand already said Strobilanthus. Yeah, Karvi. So this is actually an amazing set of plants. I mean, I am fascinated with only few set of plants, probably in, all these Impatiens or some orchids. But this plant, it's amazed me. I mean, it's I don't know how the biological clock works. So this particular plant, this Strobilanthus scundiana, this bloom only once in every 12 years. So after the bloom, the flowers will die, but the trees will be there remain. And imagine they actually calculate next 12 years. They don't bloom in every 11 years, every 12 years. So we have quite a few species of Strobilanthus in Western Ghats. Some will bloom in every 10 years, some in 6 years. There is a species which bloom every 16 years. So imagine how do they bloom all this.
So David, now the Latin name has become Nilgirianthus, no, of this one?
Yeah. Next one. So I just want to point out there's an amazing book just come out a few months ago, which is written by one of the authority on this Strobilanthus. This is called, written by Dr. Jomi Augustine. I mean, those who are very keen on these flowers, please buy it. It's reported he's recorded all this Strobilanthus. It's a lifetime work. I mean, you must see it. It's amazing. Very good quality. Please go and buy it. I mean, it's worth of every penny. Okay, next one.
David, if I can just add one more thing here, as a clarification. So many people, the Nilgiri, the word Nilgiri has not come from eucalyptus, but from the Nil color, blue colored flowers of Karvi or Strobilanthus. So that is the reason the blue mountains or Nilgiri is from Strobilanthus.
Yeah.
And not from eucalyptus, which is an Australian plant.
So again, another two interesting plants. One is called Nymphoides Balakrishnani. It's named after V.C. Balakrishnan. Another Nymphoides Krishna Kesara. So these two interesting small water lilies, they come out only for a month or two, August to October. And especially in Laterite Plateau in northern Kerala, they'll come out and they bloom and disappears. They'll die. So it's amazing how all these flowers are survive and very unique plants. I mean, so Laterite Plateaus are actually a rich biodiversity areas there. Okay, next one. Again, this is one of the amazing thing I I mean, I'm sure Anand was also there. We were just going out for a frog watch in one of our dragonfly meet in Tatekar. So I still remember, I mean, Prasenjit, he just pointed, hey, David, look at here to the left. So suddenly we switched off our torches. Amazing thing glowing in the darkness. So this is a mushroom. I mean, the picture what you see inset, that is actually, I took it with the flash, and the one which is glowing, it's without flash. It's amazing how these creatures exist in our forest. I mean, it's amazing to see all of them. Okay, the next one. There is another exciting plant recently discovered from Western Ghats. It's called Sahyadri Fiery Lantern, Thismia sahyadrica. So interestingly, this plant, most of the year, they'll actually, they live underground. They'll come out only probably a few weeks, and they don't have any chlorophyll in their body. They don't have any leaf. So what they do, they grow on the mosses and all. They'll take out all the nutrition from that, and they'll die after that. So it's a very unique plant. I mean, this is the only species which is found in India. I mean, most of the species are found in Sumatra and other rainforest and all. So this is the only species which recently described from 2017 from Western Ghats. Next one. This is again a yellow slipper orchid, Papiaphyllum drui, which is found in southern Western Ghats, especially in Agastya-Malay Hills. One sad story about this flower is the collectors from all across Western Ghats, they went and collected from the wild. This plant is almost got extinct from the wild, except 2-3 of them. Now slowly it's started coming back, but just please go to the next slide, then you'll see what's happening with this plant. So this is what is happening. So people have been collected all this plant, and they are selling it in the websites, and they are making money out of it. So this is a big racket also, it's happening. Okay, next slide.
And please, if you find such information anywhere, you can report that page to us and to the forest department also.
Forest department, yeah.
Yeah, please.
Yeah. One amazing, very colorful, beautiful a tarantula, which is a Haploclastis Deva Mother, which is found in southern Western Ghats. Interestingly, when they found this spider, describe it, I mean, look at the colors. It's very beautiful. Next slide, please. Which was already up in for sale for $140, $150. So imagine, these are our precious thing in Western Ghats. So the moment people, I mean, scientists go out and put effort, study, describe new species, but there are people out there to collect and, you know, put it in the pet trade. So this is a big threat for all our species in Western Ghats, especially the smaller stuff. We don't realize all these things. No? Next slide. Okay, I'll just point out a few more things. I mean, when you speak about all these amazing animals in Western Ghats, there are a lot of the major problems also happening. I mean, 2013, that was in Uttarakhand. That's pictures below. It's in Malabar, it happened. All these landslides and floods. I mean, in 2018, I mean, the biggest flood we Kerala ever faced, I think. Over 500 people died. Lots of people lost their houses and dear ones. So what is happening these days? I mean, the world is changing. Next slide, please. I'm rushing a bit because we have we don't have much time. So what you see here, this is the recent landslide from Munnar region. So this is Pettimudi. So if you look at that, it is actually scary. So this landslide actually originated from a primary Shola forest.
Yeah.
This is scary. People have never touched there. So when we done some studies and all, it's happening all over Western Ghats. It's not just it's there in Silent Valley, it's there in Periyar, it's there in Nilambur. So most of this forest actually has been, you know, getting a lot of landslide. Just because the weather pattern is changing, the rain is changing, we are getting a sudden rain, like 500, 600 millimeter rain within a span of 2-3 days. So that most of the forests can't handle those kind of rain. So eventually all the forests will eventually crash out. So that's what happened. Yeah. The next slide. It's all because of us people. So look at all this the carbon dioxide that people are emitting. I mean, US is causing the most, 30%, and Europe is almost 27%. We are also not far behind Asia and China, not almost 12%. But look at Africa, it's just 2.5. But still, people will blame all the other countries, the developing countries. But yeah, I think, for me, when people talk about, big conservation, sometimes people say, okay, let's plant a tree and conserve. No, I think it's not the way to do it. It's actually the government has to step in. They have to stop all these big polluters, big corporates, whatever doing it. That's a big way to move it. Otherwise, it's going to crash in one day. Next one.
So, David, just if I can add one thing over here. Can you just go back on the slide, Amruta? If with the percent emissions of carbon dioxide, if we also add the percentage of biodiversity these areas have, for example, whether it's Asia, South Asia, and South America, they have such high level of biodiversity. All the other countries like Europe and America, they have very, very poor biodiversity. They are quite monocultural in their appearance. So all the ideas of plantations are coming from there. So that's the sad point. Sorry, continue.
Okay, no problem. Next slide. And next is a lot of diseases. All the animals are dying out. I mean, the elephant calf is actually died out of human TB. The big elephants are dying out of herpes and all other diseases. The fishes are dying out. All the cows are getting different kind of diseases. Okay, next slide.
What's the one on the left you're showing next to the elephant? What is that?
That is actually a cow.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so this is...
foot and mouth.
The tongue of a cow. Next. This is actually again a major problem, the bird flu and the pig flu, H1N1. So, I mean, if there is a hybrid version of any these viruses, it can actually wipe out the entire population, human population. I mean, I think it's going to happen soon. That's what we are watching now, this all this corona, COVID cases and all. This is actually the initial stages. Okay, the next one. I'll end my talk with the next slide. So I just want to point out one story about all these frogs are disappearing. So the frogs are actually evolved over 200 million years ago. And they are the one family which nothing got wiped out. Most of them could survive. Even the biggest extinction 62 million years ago when it happened. I mean, most of the frogs survived because they could go underground or they could hide. But past 30 years, around 20 or 30% of all the frogs population been wiped out because of one fungus. It's called the chytrid fungus, BD it's called. So, I mean, frogs are actually telling us, guys, I mean, we used to survive when there's the biggest extinction happened where the 90% of fauna been wiped out. But now we can't live. There is something serious threat happening. So this is the time to change. I think if we're not doing our looking after our nature properly, I mean, the same fate actually will happen to us. I mean, if frogs are going to get extinct, I mean, soon enough, I mean, human population also going to go. That's the sign they are giving us. Okay, next slide. Thank you. I mean, yeah, probably we can go green, plant more over trees wherever, and start using solar wherever it's possible. And yeah, thank you so much. And sorry for a lot of glitches in between. I mean, my Wi-Fi actually conked up. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to take some of the questions.
Yeah. Amruta, if you can stop screen sharing, then we can put David on spotlight. Okay. One second, participants. Where is David? I'll put him. Can you put him on spotlight? Okay. So, David, there were a few questions earlier.
Okay.
One of them, can you put your video on or that will affect the...
I don't know. I'll try. See, I'm actually on the top of my terrace.
Yeah, that's good. Okay. So, the question is, one was that you mentioned about the earthquake being invasive and creating problems. So, how do you say that earthworm is invasive, or what is the problems it's creating?
Okay, so the problem is the moment you have any invasive species, like if this earthworm is concentrating, or if it's coming, it's actually destroy all the native species, like what Lantana is doing it to our forest.
Right.
So it's actually take out the entire place. So eventually other native species won't be able to breed there, and eventually it will get extinct. It is like any other invasive species.
Correct. The other question was about the laughing thrushes. Hello?
Yeah.
So is it the same Kerala laughing thrush? Has it now been split into multiple parts, or how is it?
Okay, so how does it, we had two species before. One is the Kerala laughing thrushes. Now it's become a Palani laughing thrush.
Correct.
So the Kerala laughing thrush has two subspecies. One is the Kerala one and Ashambu one. So when they did the studies, they realized it's actually different separate species altogether. So one found in Agastimele Hills and all, south of Chengkota Gap. So that is now Ashambu laughing thrush or Ashambu chilapan. And the one which is found in Palani, it's a Palani chilapan. The other two, the Nilgiri laughing thrush or the black chin laughing thrush, which is found in Nilgiris and all, and they found another population, the other subspecies which is found in Banasura hills and other Camel Hump mountain, that is now split into a Banasura laughing thrush or Banasura chilapan. I'm still using that word. Laughing thrush.
What does the word chilapan mean?
Chilapan means it's a babbler. It's like a babbling. Right. It's a Malayalam word for babbling.
Okay, right. So Pranath had asked, can you share the name of the Karvi book, Strobilanthus book, and the author's name also?
Okay, it's actually Jomi Augustine. Its name, I think, it's Strobilanthus of Westerngard or something. I'll check and get back to you the exact name. But it's written by Dr. Jomi Augustine. If you search in Google, you will get it. Okay. Strobilanthus book, Jomi Augustine. I think somebody's already put it in the box.
Right. I think Sridhar Amanth has. Yeah.
It's an amazing book. Huh? It's worth it.
So there was another question from Sybil, that since you mentioned you are from arts background, was it ever an obstacle in your career or learning about wildlife or the environment?
See, the thing is, there's two ways to look into it. For me, to learn about wildlife, it was easy because I had a passion. I had an interest. So, but when once it comes to doing some scientific work, like when you do some surveys or if you want to do some proper scientific papers and all, that's where we lack. So that's the time we actually collaborate with our friends and all. So in our team, like it's headed by Dr. Anil Sakaria, when we study frogs. He's a veterinary doctor, but we have another amazing guy, Robin Kurin Abraham. He studies in cancer. He's the guy who actually write papers. He's the guy who do all this, all the studies and all, especially writing papers and do all this, everything. So when you work as a team, it can work out. But if you just concentrate only on scientific part, it's difficult to be a naturalist. If you just want to be a naturalist, it's difficult to be a scientist. But you need to strike a balance, I think. I think I've been doing that. So I'll try to read whatever papers I can, whatever papers being published, my friends. I'll tell them to please send it to me. I'll try to read. You know, sometimes I call them and, you know, disturb them for hours. Like there's a person here in the group, I mean, Vivek. I mean, I used to talk to him a lot about, I just try to understand the shield tails. So, I mean, he used to explain everything. I mean, I used to call him again and say, okay, explain again. So that's a way to learn, I think. I mean, sometimes you may not be able to understand, but talk to the guys, the right guys. So finding the right guys is the main key.
So, I'll take the next question. Of course, there are some lots of comments saying that a wonderful talk as usual, excellent session, wonderful. I thoroughly enjoyed one of the best biodiversity talks I've heard till date. A fantastic session. Okay. Somebody asked, is a skink a snake or a lizard?
It's a lizard. Skink, lizard. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Right. Now the next question is: do you think the banana skipper came with banana saplings brought in from Northeast India? How did it probably land here? What is your theory?
Okay. First of all, I'm pretty sure it's brought it through some banana saplings for sure.
Right. Right.
Because it is not reported in Western Ghat. First of all, in South India, and it's not many reported in and Northeast India also. But if you look at the distribution, if you just go and Google it, banana skipper or Arenata taurus, it is destroyed all the banana plantation in a lot of countries in Europe or some Southeast Asia and a lot of other countries, including Sumatra and all, they devastated all their banana plantation. So from there, probably some guy must have found some rare banana sapling. He brought it without knowing that there was some eggs on it. So eventually it is spread.
Sridhar has put in the information that Strobilanthus in the Western Ghats, India, Magnificent Role of Nature in Speciation. That's the name of the book. Okay. Priyesh is asking, all the species you said are in great threat of extinction. Is Forest Department or any NGO there in Western Ghats has taken any action for protecting these species?
Of course. I mean, they've been tirelessly working, all the Forest Department, whoever I met, all the Forest Department, all the NGOs, they have a right heart in the place. So they are all doing hard work to protect whatever they can.
Can you mention a few names of the local organizations, David?
Okay, like I'm from Kerala. I mean, whatever I learned, it's from there's an NGO called Kottayam Nature Society. So that NGO, I mean, it's a small NGO here. But imagine when there's a large lake called Vembanad Lake. It's one of the largest lake in India. So, I mean, one of the big the tourism hotel industry guys, I don't want to name it because everyone knows it.
Right.
So they wanted to buy a big island in the middle of that lake. It's called the Padaramanal Island. So that island, I mean, they already had a correspondence with the government. They were ready to pay almost 2,000 crore rupees to buy that land. I mean, that island, and to build a big floating hotel there. So this NGO stepped in. They said, no, this is our land. I mean, belongs to the nature. So they went and fought. They started with the High Court. They went to Supreme Court, and they won it, the case. So now it's come to a stage, whatever development we have to do around that lake, I mean, they have to contact this small NGO. Imagine, I mean, it's like a big thing for a small NGO. So the people are doing work there. So if everyone step in like that, no, we can make a big difference. That's what I think.
Right. Okay. So the Amruta is asking this question, that since you mentioned the palm red eye did not have any predators, is it possible that it is introduced to the Western Ghats?
It is. I'm pretty much almost 99%, like I mentioned, no? And somebody got probably from Sumatra, or someone got a sapling, had a few eggs. They actually laid clutch of eggs, probably 10 eggs were there. And they brought it, when he planted here, eventually it hatched out. They started breeding. Then they realized a lot of banana plantation. They started destroying all those plants. Then they realized, I mean, and the birds also didn't know that time. So because birds have never seen this, the larvae.
Correct.
So, but later birds figure out, oh, actually there is a larvae inside the cell. They started destroying it, eating. So birds controlled it eventually.
Right.
Yeah, it is. I'm pretty sure it's actually a
introduced
species.
Right. Another thing, Ramprasad is asking, what efforts are being taken for preventing the sale of endemic flowers, animals or birds in the market?
It is a tough decision. I think the only way what we can help, whenever we see anything like that, like this website and all, we can report to the government or the Forest Department and take action. And other thing I want to say, whatever species, all those species what I mentioned, when that orchid or that spider, if you want to collect it, you need to the help of the local people. So if you have a local NGO in that area where they are dedicated for wildlife protection, I mean, without the help of any locals, they can't take out anything. So better we probably will form more NGOs and watch groups and all.
Correct.
So that's the way we can protect it. Yeah, I think that's the only way.
Absolutely. So David, I'd also like to say that there were viewers from Facebook Live also. So Prasenjit Don was watching it, and Ramji Nagarajan, Abhay Hule, Vikram Pawar. So they've all said that one of the most fantastic presentations that they've seen. Now, I have a question to you over here. Is that all this data is there in the scientific format in scientific communities. What about the todas? What about the, you know, irulas? And what about the local communities who are there? Do they distinguish between one shieldtail and the other? Are they involved in any which ways? And should they be, like, how can we engage them with this conservation process? Because, you know, otherwise scientists do their work, but the local communities and the tribal communities who have also some traditional knowledge, that is there with them if it is not shared with them? Is there some effort or are there efforts that you know?
Okay, first of all, I'll tell you a small story on the purple frog when we were studying those purple frogs.
Yeah.
So the local people knew that before it was discovered. It was discovered in 2003. But you know, the purple frog, the male and female, the female actually also make a sound. That is one of the frog which actually female also calls out. So the local people actually have a name for, local name for it, even for male and female frog. It's called Kurua and Kurati.
Right.
So, I mean, imagine local people had so much knowledge that and they know where to find all the frog. I mean, so even I'm pretty sure this Irulas and all, they know about everything about snake, but they may not be able to differentiate from a Plecturus or a Platyplectus, some different genus of sheathtails, but they know that this is a snake which don't bite. I mean, if you show it to some scientist also, a reptile enthusiast also, they may not be able to identify sheathtail. I mean, everyone's scared of that. Nobody wants to study it, or very few people want to study it. Then also they make a lot of mistakes. But if you can bring them into a scientific thing, we can learn a lot. Yeah, I'm pretty sure the amount of knowledge they have on about the forest, it's amazing. I mean, I have to mention one more guy. I mean, this is a person who passed away. It's called Kannan from Western Ghat. That's probably from Periyar Tiger Reserve. He passed away a few years ago. I never met a guide who was so much of knowledge in my life. I met a lot of naturalist scientists who knows a lot about. He knew all the snakes. He knew because he worked with Romulus Whittaker and National Geographic. In there, he knew all the plants, and I still remember when we were there for a survey, probably 10-12 years ago. Everyone was staring at a fig tree, so nobody knew what it was. So somebody said, "Call Kannan." So some Kannan suddenly walked in. I mean, he's a self-taught tribal guy there. I mean, and he just walked in. Kannan just walked in. He looked at the plant. He said, "Oh, this is Ficus racemosus, the brown palm sweet likes a lot, and some other trees and some other." Birds and all, he mentioned and just walked away. And we were doing elephant survey in the middle of the forest at night. Then we heard some sound. This is, I didn't know the call. This is almost 15 years back. Then he just, "Oh, that is Oriental scops." I was shocked. I mean, the amount of knowledge all those people have, amazing. There are guides who can identify over 100 butterflies and dragonflies in Western Ghat in Periyar. Amazing. So we have to use all those knowledge.
Right. One question that I had left, moved it a little lower, was by Deepak Gurjar. He's asking that whether Sri Lanka and Western Ghats are, ecologically kind of connected biodiversity regions. What are the species that are common between these two areas, Western Ghats and Sri Lanka?
Quite a few species. I mean, like quite a few birds also. So I think around 20,000 years, if I'm not wrong, around 20,000 years back, this was connected through it. That's why elephant could go, leopard passed through it, a lot of flora and fauna went. And I've been talking to a friend, there's a sheathtails also, it is there in Sri Lanka, but one genus, that is only Rhinophis. But we don't know the theory, we are yet to figure out why there is only Rhinophis there. There's a lot of flora and fauna which is common in Sri Lanka. Quite a lot.
But speciation of certain things has taken it faster. And you can see
if you just talk about the frogs, especially there is no gliding frogs in Sri Lanka. And there is no bush frogs also, no Rawar chestas. So probably what happened when the species all went there, they started colonizing in Sri Lanka. They started evolving into a pseudophyllatus. So you see this in Sri Lanka and all, the large pseudophyllatus, probably like our Malabar gliding frog, size of pseudophyllatus. And the same time, we don't have, I think they have over 100 species of, or 50 species of pseudophyllatus. But in Western Ghat, we have only 3 species. But we have other genuses.
Rawar chestas.
It's amazing how the speciation happened.
Great. We've had almost 2 hours of nonstop talks, photographs. And if we, David, you would have included species of ants and species of, several other taxa that are there. I think we'd have at least just for, the Southern Western Ghats region, I think there could be another 5 talks that you can very easily entertain us and, educate us. I can tell you personally that I've learned a lot from today's session, that there's a lot.
Sorry for all the glitch here, because my Wi-Fi just stopped working a few times.
No, that's what happened.
I'm really sorry.
We're very grateful to you, David, that, you agreed. And we can see definitely the passion that is there, the documentation that you're doing, and again, I would like to repeat that then a science degree or an arts degree or a commerce degree, if you have the dedication, if you have the intention to do it, you know, the way you sort of network with all the people, whether they are photographers, whether they are writers, and governmental organizations also, you work very closely with government organizations. So I think that's another thing that we need to learn, that there are bridges that we need to build and work together. It's no one body can, you know, or one person can do conservation work so well. So yeah, David has shared his email address and phone number with you.
If anybody, any doubt, you know.
Yeah.
And if you have any questions on any lorries or other cryptic species like shield tails and all, I'll pass on to my friend. So they'll get the answers.
David, also I would like to request you that if you can put the names or the details of where they can find the last two books that you've written. He's written a fantastic book on the biodiversity of the Central India. It's absolutely fabulous, you know, that you can utilize in field, that you must
get called, a copy of. It's called Wildlife of Central. I mean, me and my friend, Sridhar Ramachandran.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we co-authored that book. I mean, now both of us are working another book. So hopefully it will be out in a few months. Hopefully.
Right. So maybe we can have a launch, you know, after you've launched that, you can give us a presentation on that as well.
Yeah, it will be. I mean, it's a lot of learning. I mean, it's about also we are trying to bring out something. It's handy where we can carry into the jungle. Also, right. Basic information published in a good way, printed well, nicely. So let's see.
Yeah. So we've had, of course, lot of international viewers over here. Vince Adam has been here from Malaysia. Sahas Barve was there from the US. And earlier there was a few more persons, people who kind of joined in from various parts. So thank you so much, David.
Thank you so much, pleasure, thank you everyone for giving this opportunity. Yeah.
Oh, my pleasure. I'd like to also announce that next month we are going to have a fantastic talk on 18th of September by another very, very eminent conservationist, that is Pradeep Kishan, who's written The Trees of Delhi.
Wow.
And before I forget and before I, you know, sound ungrateful, this nonstop, you know, session and possibility of having more than 100 people at any given point of time, there were 115, 120 online people. So I'd like to thank Dwij Das and Mahesh Samant for providing us this facility of the platform. You know, I think that's another collaboration that we've learned, that very easily organizations are offering us their platforms so that more people can engage and participate in such sessions. And it's there on Facebook also live. So thank you, Dwij, to be, you know, a facilitator and to help us host this session, and to Youthful India and Mahesh Samant for providing us this platform very, very graciously. Thank you, Amrita, Siddharth, Sneha, and Rahul from the Sprouts team, who've done a lot of background work and who always remain in the backdrop. And I forget to, you know, thank them for the efforts that they do. Amrita has actually put the link for the Wildlife of Central India photographic guidebook in the chat, which you can take also from. So please do follow us on social media, Sprouts Environment Trust. And once again, thank you, David. Thank you, all of you.
Okay, pleasure. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And please join us again for the next session. We will be sending you the link, and the signing up link is sent on the same date at around 11 a.m. So please be patient with us. Thank you and be safe. Please keep documenting. Put it up on iNaturalist. Put it up on India Biodiversity Portal. Don't keep it stuck inside your computers and laptops. Get it identified from all the field naturalists that are there. You know, there might be great discoveries that you might come up with also. You know, there might be data sitting with you, which might be something which is very unique. So please don't keep your data and information stuck in your computers. If somebody is wanting to write a book or something, like when I wrote the book on Mahabaleshwar, David very graciously offered us all the photographs of that book. So, you know, I think these are some of the things that all of us should learn to be, you know, sharing about. So thank you so much and good night. Have a great weekend. Thanks, David.